Fantastic. Thank you, church, for making a difference around the world. We're actually in the process of launching that new campus down in Swaziland, and many of you have made that possible over the last few years, and we're grateful for that, and also grateful for serving those families in our community, and we will continue to do so up until Christmas and throughout the next year. And so, again, thank you. I do want to invite you and your family back next weekend and the following weekend, which will be two special weekends. It's Christmas weekend and then New Year's weekend. And we'll be changing our times all around as a church. And so you may want to check those times in the print material or on the website, because you'll want to be at one of those services. Next weekend, we have a Friday night family candlelight communion service, where we'll be doing a communion service on the 23rd. And then on the 24th and the 25th, the services will be totally different than the Friday night service. And we'll be doing our Christmas services, two on Saturday, two on Sunday. We've restructured the times so that you and your family can enjoy Christmas and then also maybe serve at Christmas. Maybe you want to celebrate Christmas all day long on Christmas and then come at the 5 p.m. service. That would be awesome. Or maybe you just want to get up early on Christmas morning and then come to the 11 a.m. service, or come on Christmas Eve to one of those services. And so we hope we have created an environment for you and your family to come to, worship Jesus, and really experience Christmas how he intends for us to experience Christmas. And then we're creating a special New Year's weekend where we're going to be doing baptisms on Saturday night, having a big New Year's party here. I know you all like to party on New Year's Eve, and so I want to encourage you to come here on the 31st, because we're going to have an incredible night of worship, and we're going to be celebrating New Year's here as a church. We're going to be doing baptisms, doing services, and we're changing those times all around. I just need to give you that information, because I don't want you to show up next weekend at the wrong time or the next weekend, though God's going to do some amazing, amazing things. If you just walked in the door and you're new to Barefoot Church, I just want to say we've been in a teaching series over December called Manger to Majesty. And we're really looking at what God sent to be born in a manger, grew up in life, fulfilled his purpose, was basically nailed to a cross, defeated death. And the Bible states him today, not as a suffering servant, but as a risen, majestic king. And his life teaches us so much about our life and the relationship our Creator wants with each and every one of us. God created you and me to be in relationship with him, the Creator. Though that relationship was broken in the Garden of Eden with the first man and the first woman, the Bible says they missed the mark of God's glorious standard of why he created them. They sin. You may have heard it framed in that way, but sin is simply missing the mark of God's amazing, glorious standard. The Bible says that the relationship was broken. Sin separated people from God. But can I tell you something? It didn't separate God from people. And so it blinded people to the relationship God wanted with them. However, God began to pursue and illustrate that he wanted a relationship with humanity from front to back throughout all the Bible. He's an illustrative God. God is an illustrative God. He doesn't just have things recorded through writers in the Bible, though those are significant things and those are how God reveals himself to us. But down through the ages, God has manifested and revealed himself to humanity in very illustrative ways. He's a creative God and he desires for us to have a connection to him. And so this story of Jesus coming as a baby in a manger has so much more to teach us about our relationship with God and our Father than sometimes meets us in at the surface of just seeing it. And so when Jesus comes, he illustrates that, you know what? He was a baby in full dependency upon his heavenly Father, as you and I would depend upon a parent or a guardian if we were an infant in the world. You know God wants you to be dependent upon him, don't you? In other words, if you're not dependent upon God in that relationship, you'll never understand what that relationship is all about. God desires a personal relationship with everyone underneath the sound of my voice. He desires to relate to you and relate to me as his children, as a part of his family, as a part of his kingdom. Now, when Jesus was growing up, and he grew up, he basically grew up in an environment that had two schools of teaching. One was a Hebrew model, the other was a Greek model. And Jesus predominantly taught by the Hebrew model. The Greek model would be much like I'm talking here today, where you would sit, someone would talk, you would listen, and then you would go away and try to apply it to your life. And there was much of that teaching going on in Jesus's day, and still much of that kind of teaching going on in our culture today. But there was also a predominant model of teaching called the Hebrew model of teaching, and that's typically what Jesus used in order to teach. And that model was simply watch what I do what I do, and experience what I experience. And so he walked with people and he modeled what he wanted them to experience. And he's a perfect model of what it looks like to be in relationship with a heavenly Father. He was in perfect relationship with the Father in heaven, your creator and my creator, from start to finish. And so he models something significant to us. He was born in a manger as the Savior of the world. And the Bible teaches that he is in full dependency upon his Father. And then as we looked last week, he grew up, and the Bible speaks of him as a 12-year-old young man, basically learning to stand in his purpose. 100% dependent upon the Father, stands in the purpose that he was given as he was sent into this earth. And he stood in his purpose all the way to the point of death for you and me on a cross, and fulfilled his purpose. And so the life of Christ teaches us dependency. It teaches us that we have a significant purpose. And then it also teaches us that one day we're going to rest in victory. And that's what I want to talk to you about today, about resting in the victory that God has in store for you and me. In order to talk about resting in the victory, you have to really begin to understand you're not just a human being, but you're an eternal being. You're an eternal being that's in this earthly body. The Bible says that one day this earthly body, as good as it looks, is going to return to dust. You know? And that's interesting because it says that we will get a heavenly body if we have believed in who Jesus is. And so you and I will not live in these earth suits forever and ever and ever. However, we are eternal beings, and we will have an eternal body in an eternal world with an eternal king. And the Bible says he's the king of an unshakable kingdom that outlasts any kingdom that has ever existed here on earth. And you and I have the opportunity, and we have the hope to be a part of that and begin to understand a little bit and elevate our thinking beyond this life into eternal life and really begin to understand what it means to rest in victory. The Bible gives a description of Jesus resting in the victory that he has, in the position he has forever and ever and ever. So today we're going to look at him resting in his victory and the imagery the Bible gives of him. And then he turns around and tells the writer, you know what, I want you to turn around and write the people, the church, what it looks like for them to be victorious. So if you have your Bible with you today, I invite you to turn it to the last book, the book of Revelation. Now, Revelation is a fantastic and grand book because what it does, it begins to elevate our thinking. It begins to elevate our hope in eternal things. And it's one of my favorite books, you know, because I can begin to see things through my spiritual being and what basically God has in store for me. And you can, now a lot of people are afraid to look at the book of Revelation, but it says there in the opening, as this man named John pens this letter of what was revealed to him through King Jesus in his resurrected state, The Bible says, as he begins to pen it, that anyone who reads it, who listens to that letter, and obeys that letter will be blessed. So, you know, a lot of people don't ever want to talk about the book of Revelation. And the reason is because of the imagery our world has given that book. As you know, as it's the, it means it's the end of the world. Can I tell you something? It's really the beginning. And this is what people miss. The world we live in today is marred. And it is defiled by this thing called sin. And so the book of Revelation gives us what it looks like to be in connection with God for eternity. And the future is bright. The Bible is a story about God connecting with people, redeeming people, paying a price for people, and then giving them an eternal hope and an eternal future. It's a beautiful, beautiful story. And no matter what circumstance you're in today, no matter what financial stress you're under, no matter what physical condition your life and sickness is in your body today, no matter what relational challenge you have in life, my friends, if you begin to understand who this Jesus that came in a manger grew up to be, you can have eternal hope, and it is simply amazing. It is amazing. So I want to talk through this book today. Revelation is kind of like that small present under your Christmas tree. It's the small present that reveals something much more. In other words, if maybe you've opened up a present like this on Christmas morning at some point in time in your life, or maybe you will open up a present like this one morning in your life. And, you know, maybe some of you ladies have opened up that small present, that 4-carat diamond ring. And you got so caught up in the diamond ring, you didn't see past the diamond ring at the hope the diamond ring was going to bring. Now, that's what happens to some people sometimes when they open up the small presents under the tree. But the book of Revelation is intended to show us that we can have hope and give us a glimpse that there's something much more to this thing called life than we currently see with our eyes today. And so it's like opening up this small present that has a set of Ferrari keys in it, and you're 16 years old at Christmas time. Anybody ever opened up that gift at Christmas time in the room today? Okay, maybe it was like me. It was keys to a Pinto. Some of y'all don't even know what a Pinto is. But anyway, the point is, maybe the parents give a gift under the tree that it's a set of keys to something you cannot see. But because of your relationship with the parents, and you know that they are good parents, and they are a parents that would always give you more than you could think of or imagine because they are highly in love with you, whenever you open the keys, you don't think that they're trying to trick you. You begin to search out for things you cannot see, which is like the Ferrari in the garage. You're like, oh my goodness, I can't see what is outside of this room, but I know because of what I have in my hand, it is good and it is amazing. See, that's what the book of Revelation is all about. It's about a revealed king who gives us hope beyond the small package under the Christmas tree. He begins to expand our understanding of God and how we're eternal beings and we have an eternity to look forward to. And that's why he says at the beginning of the letter, anyone who reads this, anyone who listens to it, follows it, obeys it, they're going to be blessed by a God in a powerful, powerful way. And so let this be a message of hope today. And I know that the baby in the manger may melt your heart, but Jesus came not to just melt your heart. Jesus came to basically manage your life and show you your majestic eternity. And so many people are just in love with the baby in the manger. But I hope you fall in love with the one who resurrected from a grave today to give you eternal life. If you got your Bible with you, turn it to the book of Revelation, chapter 1. And here's a description that John wrote down as he heard a voice speaking to him about what he saw whenever he turned to see. It starts in Revelation chapter 1 and begins with verse 12. He says, when I turned to see who was speaking to me, he says, I saw seven golden lampstands, and standing in the middle of the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man, a term that Jesus would often use to describe himself when he was walking physically here on earth. And so John says, look, when I turned to see who was speaking to me in this vision, in this revelation, it was that baby who was in a manger who later grew up to a 12-year-old and began to live out his purpose. The one that I saw get nailed to a cross, he says, and resurrect from the grave, it was him. And he goes on to say, he was wearing a long robe with a gold sash across his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow. And his eyes were like flames of fire. His feet were like polished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice thundered like the mighty ocean waves. He held seven stars in his right hand, and a sharp two-edged sword came from his mouth, and his face was like the sun in all its brilliance. He goes on to say, when I saw him, now imagine, put yourself in those shoes. When I saw him, he says, I fell at his feet as if I were dead. In other words, this being was so majestic, so brilliant, so powerful. When he spoke, his voice sounded like the ocean waves thundering. He spoke as one in complete authority. He says, when I saw him, I fell to his feet as if I were dead. But he laid his right hand on me and said, the same words he wants to say to you today, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. How many people today live in fear of what they have not yet seen? And Jesus simply says, John, don't be afraid. And the reason you don't need to be afraid is this. He says, I am the first and the last. I am the living one. Remember, I died. He says, but check it out. But look, I am alive forever and ever. He says, I hold the keys. This is key. He says, I hold the keys. I hold the keys of death and the grave. Go ahead, he tells John, write it down. Write down what you have just seen, both the things that are now happening and also the things that will happen. And the book of Revelation is all of that. What he just saw, what he was about to see, and what he would later see. And as you begin to study the book of Revelation, you see this Jesus who revealed himself in the very beginning, saying, I'm a majestic king. You have nothing to fear in life. And the reason why is I have unlocked the hope of eternity for you, and death no longer can hold you back. I hold the keys of death and the grave, and your eternal hope has been unlocked. My question to each and every one of us is, if our eternal hope in a risen king has been forever unlocked, why in the world would you let anyone lock you out of your future? Why would you let anyone lock the door on the hope for the future? Why would you let the enemy, who Jesus came and said, no longer will death hold, you know what, my people back. No longer will sin hold my people back. I have justified them. I have come to give justice. I will pay the price for sin on a cross for all humanity. And no longer do they have to be disconnected from the God of the universe. Death doesn't have a hold on them. They don't have to be afraid of death. They don't have to be afraid of the enemy. They don't have to be afraid of anything. Why would you let the enemy hold you back from hoping in the future, whenever he begins to steal your joy, as you worry about tomorrow, as your brain begins to play tricks on you and your mind begins to think that, you know what, life is just about today and there is no eternal future. Jesus says, look, I hold the keys. So my question for everybody here today is, why don't you let him open the hope of eternity in your heart and in your life? Why would you let what is happening now hold you back from the hope that Jesus has for you in the future? Victorious. And the reason you are victorious is because he paid the price on a cross. So I want to talk to you about what it means to stand in victory, to rest in victory, and what your eternal future really, really holds. Because what happens a lot of times is people don't see what Jesus is trying to peel back for us to see. They just look at the wrapping paper and think, oh, what a beautiful gift. What do I mean by that? This is what Revelation is all about. Life here on earth is the wrapping paper. What's inside of the wrapping paper? Jesus wants to peel back. So you'll begin to put your hope in what's inside the wrapping paper, not the wrapping paper itself. And so many people are seeing this big box under the tree. And instead of wondering what's inside of the box for eternity, they're like, that is one cute bow on the package. That's some amazing, amazing wrapping paper. Again, this life here on earth is the wrapping paper. God has more than you can imagine, more than you can think of, more than you can ever hope about on this side of eternity for your life. But what happens is sometimes we get caught up in the wrapping paper. Revelation is about pulling back the wrapping paper and showing you what's inside and what is still yet to come. So when the wrapping paper gets torn a little bit here on earth, you don't just try to keep wrapping the package over again with beautiful wrapping paper, but you begin to take a peek inside and have hope beyond the wrapping paper. And so what Jesus does is he gives a description of who he is, and he's resting. He's the eternal king. He's the king of glory. He's amazing. He's the king of an unshakable kingdom. He will put every enemy under his feet as a footstool, and he's waiting for people to be overcomers like he's been an overcomer. And in eternity, when we get a glimpse of that, it begins to change everything about how we do life. One writer says to the church in Colossae, he says, hey, set your mind on things above, not the wrapping paper here on earth. Set your mind on things above, not the things here in the earth. And so what I hope to do today, because it's really easy in our culture to see the wrapping paper and miss the eternal prize. And so what I want you to do today is see that you're victorious. You're victorious if you have believed in this Jesus, the one who came in a manger, who grew up and fulfilled his purpose, allowed himself to be nailed to a cross, defeated death, and rose from a grave. If your heart is connected to this Jesus, I need to demonstrate to you the victory that you have, because you belong to something called the church. And what Jesus does in the next two chapters of Revelation, he speaks to John and says, pen these things down. I got something I want to say to the church. So he speaks to seven different churches. And in the seven different churches, he speaks about the things they were knocking it out of the park with. He begins to speak about the things that they were missing on. And then he begins to encourage them to get it right. And then he begins to show each church a snapshot of what the future looked like whenever they were victorious in living this life he designed for them to live. God has a purpose for your life. And through the seven churches, he basically states the purpose of the church, which you and I belong to, and the purpose of, you know, basically how we need to begin to align our life with King Jesus. And he speaks of several things through there, but I boiled it down in just a little package here of all the things he spoke of to the seven churches that we should be practicing as we have hope in looking into eternity. And this is the list. We need to learn to trust. We need to learn to endure. We need to learn to work out our purpose. We need to learn to love. Love God and love others. Have sound understanding of who God is. Depend completely on him. Encourage others. Don't get attached to the things of this world and keep on hoping. He says, man, if the church could learn to live life like that, he says, and keep their hope on what is still yet to come, he says they would begin to knock it out of the park, because this life, the wrapping paper, sometimes brings some things that discourages them, but I want to get their hope above those things, and I want them to start living life like they have an eternal future. So he speaks to every church. At the end of every church he speaks to, he makes a statement about victorious living. And I want to show you those seven statements today, because you need to be encouraged. There's hope beyond this life. Because you may have, again, a sickness in your body, and you may not even be guaranteed tomorrow here on earth. And the wrapping paper is looking very dim for you. Or maybe for you, your wrapping paper is gold and shiny and got sparkles all over it. But inside, you're empty. I need you to grab hold of the hope that eternity holds for you, because God wants to say something to you about your eternity. And sometimes it's hard to paint the picture of what's inside the package. And so John tries to do that and tell them what victorious life looks like. Revelation 2, he speaks to the first church. He tells them what's wrong, tells them what's right, tells them they need to learn to turn to their first love they had. And then he says, anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. To everyone who is victorious, he says, I will give fruit from the tree of life in the paradise of God. So what is he saying? Have hope. If you believed in me, he says, and you've been living out your purpose here on earth, you've got hope, because I'm going to give you a fruit from the tree of life in paradise. Can I tell you, the tree of life was in the Garden of Eden, and it was amazing. The Garden of Eden was a place that God intended for the first man and the first woman to live for eternity. With all the provision, it was a palatial place. It was with all the provision, all the hope, all the protection, anything anybody would ever need. And he says, be victorious, because you're going to eat from this tree of life forever and ever and ever. And that should give you hope beyond this life. The next church he speaks to, he says, man, I want you to learn to live victorious. He says, I want you to learn to have hope beyond this life, because victory is coming. If he can raise a man from the grave that was crucified like Jesus, do you not believe that he can offer you and I that same hope that the resurrection offered King Jesus? And he's trying to paint a picture for you. Because in life, sometimes we get caught up in the wrapping paper. And God's saying, oh, life, my friend, is so much more than 70, 80, 90 years here on earth. It's eternal. The second church, he speaks to them, and he says in Revelation 2:11, he says, whoever is victorious will not be harmed by the second death. And in this church that he's speaking to was a church that was being persecuted. People that were being slaughtered and killed physically here on earth for their faith in Jesus. It was a church that was impoverished. Poverty had stricken this church because the governmental officials didn't like their message and would not allow them to have certain things. And he's saying, look, I need you to hang on. He says, I know that the wrapping paper's tough, but you hang on to hope. He says, because you know what? You are really rich. He tells that church, it ain't about the wrapping paper. He says, it's about what's inside. And you may be being persecuted, which the church in America is not being persecuted, you know, and we see churches all over the world that are being persecuted. He's saying, if that is you, you know what? This life don't matter because you are not going to face the second death. You may die once, but you don't have to die twice. You're an eternal being with an eternal future. The question for you and me is, will we die once or will we die twice? And death twice means being separated from God in a real place called hell forever and ever and ever. And he's saying, you may be persecuted today. They may chop your head off. They may withhold tax dollars from you. However, he says, hang on. He says, have hope beyond the wrapping paper. Because my friend, what is still yet to come is simply amazing. And then the next church, he speaks to that church and he says, look, I'm a resurrected king and I need you to have hope. And he says to everyone in this church who is victorious, I will give some of the manna that has been hidden away in heaven. Hidden manna, manna being a substance that fell from heaven that allowed the Israelites to go through the desert. It was provision from God. Manna is provision from God. He says, and I will give to each one of you a white stone, and on that stone will be engraved a new name that no one understands except the one who receives it. And so what he says here to this church, he's saying, man, if you can endure and just keep going, he says, the only way you're going to do that is understand that I have provision that waits you that is hidden. It's like provision that no one has ever seen. So I don't know what you depend upon for your provision, but the Bible says there's some hidden provision and in the life that is yet to come that no one has ever seen. That is going to be simply amazing. And what that means is your heavenly Father will provide for you every single day of your life with a hidden provision that you have never seen before in your life. And then it goes on to say that, you know what, not only is he going to provide for you like a good father daily for everything you need, it says that you are going to have a special name that only you and your father, no. It's kind of like whenever a dad gives his daughter, his son, that nickname that's only between the dad and the daughter or the dad and the son. And he's saying, you know what, in eternity, you're that special. Every one of you is that special. He says, look, I know they're talking about you here, church. I know they're persecuting you. I know they're speaking against you and saying that you'll never amount to anything. And he says, no, just keeping on. And it really don't matter what they say about the wrapping paper. It's really about what's inside. I don't know about you, but my heart hopes whenever things come against me in this life that I have special provision that's on the way, coming down the pipe in eternity that nobody has ever seen. And I got a heavenly father. And guess what? I'm his boy and I got a special name. Do you have that hope? Do you really see eternity that way? Or are you just kind of checking out the wrapping paper and thinking about how bad it's here? He's like, listen, look, this is a shadow. It's screwed up. I know you think it's good, but that's a tactic of the enemy to make you and I think where we are now is this is like a trash dump. It doesn't really matter what we think. God's trying to give a demonstration. I didn't create it to be defiled like it is, to have thorns in the flower bed. Man, you could have walked in the flower bed and picked the roses without thistles and thorns. Wouldn't that have been amazing? Oh, we don't have any gardeners in the house today. I mean, he didn't create it that way. He created it to be eternal, but see, man missed the mark of God's glorious standard. And he's trying to paint a picture. Look, I'm making all things new, a new heaven, a new earth. I'm going to give you a brand new body. Hang on to the hope that you have. And not only hang on to the hope you have, endure. Today is just today, all right? And the Bible says a day to God is like 1,000 years. And we got to grab hold of, we're eternal beings, and it's not as bad as we think it is whenever we set our eyes on things above and not just here on earthly things. The next church, he speaks to them. He says, hey, to all of you who are victorious, who obey me to the very end, that's key. In other words, don't just start the race, finish it. You know, there's Bible writers who talk about things like that. Paul says, look, he says, I don't want to just start the race. As a matter of fact, he says, I discipline myself in such a way so I can finish the race because I'm afraid if I don't finish right, I'm going to lose something in eternity. He said, I run the race to win. I run this life on purpose. He said, I ain't just shadow boxing. I'm living life on purpose. Every morning my feet hit the floor because I know that the life here will someday end, but I'm more interested in what is still yet to come. Does that describe you? Because see, that's when obedience begins to flow out of your heart and your life. Not because, you know what, you're afraid, but because you're embracing the hope that is still yet to come. The Bible goes on to say, to them I will give authority. Everybody say authority. And it will be rightful authority over all the nations. They will rule the nations with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. Jesus goes on and says, hey, I need you to tell them that they will have the same authority I receive from my Father, and I will also give them the morning star. This speaks of a kingdom. And Jesus says, you need to help them have hope that I have an unshakable kingdom coming, and there will be rank and there will be order, and I will put people in authority over cities, over nations, over different things. And see, that just gives me hope. Because, you know, no matter whether I have a good position here or not, and nothing wrong with having a good position, because I want to endure to the end, and I want to persevere to the end, and I want to live out the kingdom life here on earth as it is in heaven, I understand that with that, the hope of having an eternal resting place is simply amazing. Some people get confused because they're like, they think heaven is Hollywood, or Hollywood is heaven. What people put on the TV, that we're all gonna be in this eternal life floating around like little cherubs with wings and little tails. And honestly, that is a false picture, my friend. The Bible says that you're an eternal being, and God has given you the authority to be a ruler and a reigner for all eternity. The Bible says that you'll get a brand new heavenly body. The Bible says that, you know what, you're gonna live forever and ever and ever. And so my question is, you know, again, to you and me, is do you see this picture? Now, I don't completely understand, though I'm trying to dig some of this out. A theological question to begin to ask yourself is, well, if eternal life is about ruling and reigning, who are we going to be ruling and reigning? You may want to answer that question. I'm not going to answer it for you because I'm still digging it out. But I would say to you that it is a kingdom. There is rule, there is reign, and we're going to be ruling and reigning and have authority and positions over something. Go figure it out. This ain't makeshift Christianity. We're talking about eternal life and a King of Kings and a Lord of Lords who defeated death and resurrected from a grave. He's given you a snapshot, my friends, of the future. You think that America's great. That kingdom is an unshakable kingdom that has all the provision, all the purpose, all you need in life. And he says, you have the opportunity to belong to it as a son and a daughter of the King. Wow. Let that magnify and expand your hope beyond your personal situation. The next church, he said it this way. He says, all who are victorious, he says, will be clothed in white. I will never erase their names from the book of life, but I will announce before my Father and his angels that they are mine. And so this church he's speaking to is a church that appeared to be alive, but they were asleep on the inside. And so what he's saying here is, listen, I want to announce you that you are mine to the angels, to the Father in heaven. But the only way you're going to be announced that way while you still got time is not to just be a poser and acting like you're alive. He's saying, but allow me to spiritually awake you on the inside so you are really alive. And he speaks to this church about being alive. You know, some people today think they're alive because of the way they outwardly worship. Back in the day, you were alive, you know, back in the old-timey church, you were alive whenever they cut the music on and you did this. You were alive because that meant that, you know, you didn't move because you were like, you were reverent or whatever else. And we look at him like, dude, are you really alive? And honestly, it had nothing to do with that style. Now, sometimes people, you know, they act like they're alive in the millennial age. Well, I'm a millennial, right? Anyway, in this age that we live in, sometimes people, you know, look spiritually alive because of the way they hold their hands and shake their feet and, you know, dance. And it's amazing. Nothing wrong with any of that. Nothing wrong with this. Nothing wrong with this. Okay? But what he's saying is you can do all of that. Some of you are here, you're raised in a tradition where you think this means to be spiritually alive. He says, you can look the part, but unless I wake up the inside and the alarm clock don't go off, it don't matter what you pose on the outside, because you know what? The posture I'm looking for is an awakened soul, an awakened spirit that knows who I am from the manger to a resurrected King, and let that be what makes you alive. Wow. He says, that's the ones I'm going to announce. And again, I don't care if you dance, awesome. I don't care if you look like a stoic, you know, whenever we play songs, awesome. I don't care if you kneel, awesome. But let it be true worship from an alive spirit, not just watching the church culture or the next religious movement and being an imposter. He says, man, I want to announce you as belonging to me. And man, I know in my heart that when I see King Jesus with his glowing eyes, that he's going to say, you are mine, because he holds the keys to my future. Does he hold yours? Two more churches. The next thing he says, hey, I need you to remember that one day as I'm a risen king and I'm victorious, you'll be victorious too. And the next church he speaks to, he says in Revelation 3:12, all who are victorious will become pillars in the temple of my God, and they will never have to leave it. In other words, you're going to be able to be there all the time. He says, and I will write on them the name of my God, and they will be citizens in the city of my God. So does that mean there will be citizens outside the city? Then the Bible goes on to say, the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven from my God, and I will also write on them my new name. So he's saying here that you're going to have the opportunity to be marked by God live in close proximity in the same city with God and allow God just to be there all the time. And so my understanding of Scripture is that, you know what, there's going to be a city, but there's also going to be outward regions that everybody ain't going to live in that city. The Bible says God is going to create a new heaven and a new earth. I don't completely understand what that looks like, but the Bible says he's so displeased with the old one, it's going to be swept away, and he's going to build a new one. I find that fascinating, because if the wrapping paper looks this good, imagine what that one's going to look like and what you and I are going to be like. See, we need to get our hopes up, because our hope can be elevated, because if we can get it off the wrapping paper and what Jesus is trying to peel back on the inside and what's in the future, it is simply amazing. By the way, this church that he told that to, you're going to be in the city. It's interesting, because this is the only church that he doesn't say something negative about their posture and how they were being. You know why? Because it says that they were basically, they weren't a people of doing things in their own strength, that they were completely depending on God. See, dependence on God all the way through, depending on who God is and not depending on who I am, has a magnificent reward waiting on it. And so he speaks to this church, and he tells them, he says, hey, I know you have little strength. However, keep enduring, keep persevering, keep depending, because one day you're going to live in the city where God is. That is simply amazing. I don't know about you, but my heart desires to be as close to Jesus in the city of God, in the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords, as I possibly can be. Now, again, I don't want to live in the outskirts. I want to get up close and personal, don't you? And see, honestly, a lot of people don't see it this way. A lot of people are like, it's about the wrapping paper. It ain't about the wrapping paper. It's about eternity, and you are an eternal being that God desires a personal relationship with forever and ever and ever and ever. And he desires it so much, he gave his one and only son on a cross that defeated death, took the keys, resurrected from a grave to announce that we have eternal hope. And see, what happens a lot of times is people don't get a glimpse of this hope in their heart. It's great to read about it, but I'm never going to endure anything or persevere, even if the church changes the color of the carpet. I'm not going to persevere because I'm looking at the wrapping paper instead of what eternity holds. Get your hopes up. Get them on things above, not on earthly things. The last church, he says, those who are victorious will sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne. So he gives this imagery again of what honor looks like, and you know what true significance looks like. He says you're gonna be elevated to a place where I'm at. And this church he's talking to was a church that had no needs. They didn't have any financial needs. They didn't have any physical needs. And he's speaking to them. He says, here's the deal. You don't have any needs here on earth because, you know, you're all about the wrapping paper. He says, but you should have peeled back the wrapping paper and looked about what was on the inside and not been investing all your resources in the wrapping paper. You should have got some of the heavenly gold from me. Go read it. It's amazing. Revelation chapter 3. He's like, you think that honor and significance is what you have in the wrapping paper. He says, but true significance and honor comes from getting gold from me, getting things from, from me, getting your mind set on what is still yet to come. He says, now the things, what you drive and what you live in here in this earth, you know, that's fantastic. Enjoy it. But it is wrapping paper. He says, would you peel it back and begin to understand? There ain't nothing wrong with the wrapping paper as far as enjoying it, but there's so much more still yet to come. What is your faith in? Is it the wrapping paper or is it a resurrected king? Because you can believe, you know, in the baby in the manger, but miss the risen king. And without a resurrection, all of what I've been talking about for the last 3 weeks is just a pile of minutia. If there is no resurrection, we have no business being in this room today. If there is no eternal future, what we're doing here today is a waste of time. We might as well go to the show down the street. But if the resurrection is real and it pierces your heart and you get a glimpse of what eternity holds, it could change your forever. And so another writer in Hebrews 11 says that's what faith is. Let me show it to you. Hebrews 11, 1, we'll close with this today. He says, faith shows the reality of what we hope for. Faith, it is the evidence of things we cannot see. Faith shows the reality of what we hope for. Faith, it is evidence of things we cannot see. And so does your life, does your faith that you have in your life, what reality is it hoping for? Because all of us have faith. But you see, faith shows evidence of what you're hoping for. Are you hoping for what eternal life brings? Are you hoping for the things unseen that we have not seen yet? Or are you simply hoping, you know, and believing that, you know, maybe just one day I'll see a Ferrari. See, faith drives you to know there's a Ferrari. Faith drives you to know that there's an eternal future. Faith drives you to know that you've got a good heavenly Father, and he's a good Father that don't give gifts to his children. If you ask for bread, he ain't gonna give you a stone. If you ask for fish, he ain't gonna give you a snake and put it in your hand. It's knowing that the gift that God has promised humanity who believes in him from the manger to the resurrection, it's a promise to you and me that we can have hope in this life and not be afraid of anything we face, not be afraid of anything that comes at us, even death itself. What evidence does your faith display? Does it have display that you have eternal hope in Christ Jesus? Or does your faith display that you're just sad because of broken relationships? See, what God's trying to tell us is that here in this life, again, it's been marred. We can endure, and we got to encourage one another to endure. But it's not over here. It's forever. Ever and ever. And I think about a living example of what that hope looks like. And it was manifested in a man that's a dear friend of mine that clocked out of this life yesterday. And you know what? His hope was in eternal things. Because the evidence of his life was this, Though the last few years of his life, he was plagued with physical illness. Can I tell you something? He still believed in the kingdom of God and what the work of God was all about and where he was going. And that man who clocked out yesterday, who's a dear friend of mine that has been in this church since about the beginning of the church, he may be one of the guys that handed you a cup of coffee out front. As his legs and his back was aching like nobody's business, as he had things going on in his body, he still displayed he had faith in Jesus, and that hope could be offered to you and offered to me. And you know, yesterday he clocked out of this life. But his mind was on not earthly things, not the wrapping paper, but on eternal things. That's why I can celebrate with my friend who would have gave you a cup of coffee a few weeks ago out front, who now is with King Jesus. And you know what? What he heard is what I believe every one of us could hear if our faith is in the right place, is this. He heard this yesterday. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Come on in and eat from the tree of life. Come on in and get that etched stone, that special name. You know what I have for you? You're no longer Joe. You are whoever I call you in the kingdom forever and ever and ever. Come on in. You know what? And understand that we're going to rule and reign forever. That my kingdom will outlast that old kingdom you've been in. But you know what? He's saying, come on in. Come on in. And he didn't only say it to Joe yesterday. My friend, he wants to say it to you and he wants to say it to me. The question is, what will your faith be in? Is it a resurrected Jesus? Or is it just in a baby? It's in a manger. The baby in the manger may melt your heart, but a resurrected King will change your life. Can you bow your heads, please? God, I thank you so much for Jesus. I thank you for his birthday. I thank you for him leaving all his splendor and coming into this defiled earth. I thank you that he could stand in his purpose against all temptation, against all pain, against all evil, and defeat death that has plagued humanity. God, I thank you for sending him as a dependent in a manger, allowing him to illustrate how we can grow in connection to our Heavenly Father and live out our purpose, no matter what the cost is. And we can live with an expectancy and a hope in eternity where we'll be resurrected in our rightful position. And we'll be resting in that eternal position with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, ruling and reigning forever and ever and ever. God, I thank you for this Jesus. And if there's a person underneath the sound of my voice today that only has hope in the wrapping paper, the things in this world, and they don't have hope in eternal things because of who Jesus is, I'm just going to give you the opportunity to shift your focus and your heart and your faith from the wrapping paper to this Jesus that came packaged in a manger but busted out of the grave and rose to eternal life. You say, how do I do that? You just surrender. You basically just say, God, I'm tired of just focusing on the wrapping paper. I'm tired of just running my own life and thinking that life is about here and now. And God, my eyes have been opened today that I'm an eternal being. Tell God, today I want to receive the gift that you sent in a manger, that grew up and lived out his purpose, shed his blood on a cross, and bust out of the grave and defeated death. And he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Tell God you want to put your faith in that Jesus. The Bible says if you do that with your heart, that God salvages you. And there's something that just awakens inside of you. It's no longer a posture just on the outside. It's an awakening on the inside. It's a spiritual awakening. And you begin to get a new sense of purpose, a new sense of life, a new sense of hope, because you realize that today it's just a vapor. It's here and it's gone in just a little while. But eternity is real. If you said that today and you talked to God, I want to be one of the first to say, hey, thank you for surrendering your life to the work that Jesus did on a cross and his resurrection and allowing him to be the Lord, the leader, the King, and the Savior of your life. I want to say welcome to the family. God's so proud of you, and now he wants to shift your focus so you will have hope for the future and all eternity. God, we thank you for what you do through King Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.